everybody, this is Jason. Welcome to Liberty Live. Today we're going to be talking about the Siloam inscription or the Siloam tablet. Now, what is a Siloam tablet? Why are we talking about it today? First of all, Siloam is a familiar term we find in the New Testament when Jesus put clay after spitting in the ground and rubbed it on the blind man's eyes and he said, go wash in the pool of Siloam. That's exactly right. The Siloam tunnel runs exactly from one side of the city of Jerusalem through the other, leading out into the pool of Siloam. Now, what's a Siloam inscription? Let me show you. We have here a beautiful rendition of the Siloam inscription. Now, this was actually carved in after one of the greatest architectural and engineering feats in the old world. Come with me around 700 BC, when the Assyrians were besieging the nation of Israel. They succeeded in destroying Israel and driving them out, taking them captive. But when they came against Judah, the king on duty at that time was Hezekiah. Now, Hezekiah is the very famous king who had a deathly disease and prayed and was miraculously healed after he prayed and fasted. God heard him and added 15 years to his life. So when Sennacherib, who defeated basically at the time all of what we considered the modern world, the free world, the trading world, after the conquest of Israel, he came to Judah. Now, what he did was so bad. He had some of his military commanders learn Hebrew, go around the walls, and then tell all the people not to trust in Hezekiah, not to trust in the Lord, and that he was deceiving the people. On duty also was the prophet Isaiah, and Isaiah had the word of the Lord. Praise God for this. He sought the Lord, and the Lord said, not only will you not be destroyed, Sennacherib will not even enter the city. And so what ends up happening is Hezekiah offers this beautiful prayer to the Lord and says something along the lines of this: Lord, if you deliver us for your namesake, right, you will be remembered for your namesake. We are a people only because of you. Remember how I've served you. Remember all the things we've done. Remember that you've called and chosen us. Well, we can't be the us you've called and chosen if we're wiped out by this pagan king. Therefore, grant us victory that we may serve you, basically. And that's exactly what the Lord did. And there's even a relief from Sennacherib telling what they call braggadocio when he says, I went here and defeated Lachish. I went here and left them scrambling. I went here and not a man was left standing. And all of a sudden he says, I trapped Hezekiah when he gets to Judah. I trapped Hezekiah in like a bird. And then it stops. Meaning that not only did he not enter the city, but there's no tell of victory because the corroboration between this relief, which is a stone inscription telling the historicity of the kings, which we have, for example, biblically, like in Book of Chronicles, Book of Kings, or any of the scriptures and historic corroborations of the prophets, priests, kings of Israel, the apostles in the New Testament, the apocryphal writings and everything that God has done, is doing, and will do. This is the testimony that we have. Well, back then they used to write it in stone. So what is this inscription so powerful? Why is it so beautiful? Why is it so amazing and historic? Well, what ends up happening is in the 1800s, there were some British explorers who came to survey the city of Israel, Jerusalem. It had never been done before properly. So the first guy is Charles Warren. Now, let me just put these two marks on the map for you. This is Warren's Arch. This is Robinson's Arch. Between these two archways on the back side of what used to be the temple wall is the Kotel, the Western Wall, the Wailing Wall, where we go to pray, fast, and seek the Lord God and the favor of the Lord God. So what ends up happening is this guy Warren was Charles Warren. The arch was named after him. He surveyed the entire city of Israel and Jerusalem. And this guy, who this arch is named after, his name was Edward Robinson. Now, Edward Robinson rewrote and edited the famous Greek and Hebrew lexicon, which became a standard authority in America to this day. And he is the one who basically started the Palestinian Survey Foundation, which basically they are the first guys who drew a real map that was actually accurate for studying and surveying, and basically started what is now unending research and study and corroboration archaeologically, geologically, and architecturally into the old world. Okay, so while Warren goes into the shaft, comes out underneath passageways, the Spring of Gihon, he finds what he finds, but he leaves. Well, when Edward Robinson was in there, he was going and he basically felt the wall, and he finds this inscription. After reading it, it's transliterated basically to say, we were tunneling through the water. We were about 3 cubits apart, which is from my middle finger to my elbow. And next thing you know, I heard my fellow countrymen speak to his fellow countrymen, and we kept digging with axes and pickaxes, and next thing you know, our axes struck one to another. The tunnel was open, and water flew for 1,000 cubits. So here's what basically happened. When Sennacherib's besieging the city, which means he surrounds it like a fence with his soldiers. You can't leave or you'll be killed. Next thing you know, you can't leave to go get crops and water, and you basically starve out. This is also what happened with the Babylonians and Nebuchadnezzar later in 586 BC. But rewind back to Sennacherib in Assyria. He besieges the walls. Well, right when he's on the way, Hezekiah says, why should he come and find the Gihon spring and either water his troops and get strength and come after us and defeat us, or poison the water, dry it up, or block it so that we starve or die of thirst? And so he has this brilliant idea. The Lord gives it to him and his advisors to tunnel through each side of the city and to reroute the spring away from outside the walls, which is not fortified, which is totally exposed to being underground fortified and well protected. And so they start, and it's a 583-yard journey, okay? 583 yards, it's 1,500 feet around. It's a little more than that. And they tunnel through with no GPS, no sonar technology, no, they have no way to have depth meters. They have no way that we are aware of to go underneath the ground, start digging with pickaxes and limestone with water up to their waist, and end up meeting in the middle, except by the Spirit of God. This is so amazing. Let me read you just a couple of verses that capture this. In 2 Chronicles 32:30 is the epitaph of King Hezekiah. It says, the same Hezekiah closed the upper outlet of the waters of Gihon. This is the famous spring of Gihon that David crawled through with his mighty men to conquer the city originally from the Jebusites. He directed them down to the west side of the city of David, and Hezekiah prospered in all his works. It also says in 2 Kings 20:20, the rest of the deeds of Hezekiah and all his might, how he made the pool and the conduit and broke the water into the city. Are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of Judah? Meaning this was such a massive event, it's kind of written on his epitaph, which would be like his tombstone, the summary of his life, if you will. Isaiah 22:11, you made a reservoir between the two walls and watered the old pool. But you did not see him who did it or see who did it, who planned it long ago. This basically means God planned this. How could they ever succeed? God, by the Spirit of God. See, when God allows us to find these archaeological, and by the way, this was on the wall underneath the tunnel, and someone, Robertson obviously found it, then other people went there. The next thing you know, it's chiseled out and it's for sale in Istanbul, Turkey. Now it's in the museum. And in its place is a beautiful replica testifying of his story. Why is God letting us find all these things to corroborate scriptures, history, and testimony? Well, one, the message speaks on. Even though the men are dead serving God, yet they still speak, as it says in the book of Hebrews about the apostles, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God's the God of the living, not the God of the dead. But also, it shows that what God has done, not only is he able to do again, for God does not change, but that these unbelievable demonstrations of success without technology. In other words, yeah, they had technology, pickaxes and chisels and hammers. But even today, as sophisticated as we are, we can't succeed without the Spirit of God. Beloved, understand this. Without God, we're nothing, but with God, we're everything. Do you have something in your life that's a wall, a blockage, is the enemy, is a demon, devil, depravity, doubt, something that is trying to hinder you from the well of living water from the Lord Jesus Christ himself? Well, beloved, take your acts of faith, take the word of God, and begin to dig, begin to seek, begin to pray, begin to fast, especially in the days in which we live. And I tell you, as the word of God says, he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus Christ, the Lord, he changeth not. Beloved, he was for our brothers then. He is for you now. He is for us. God is for us. Who can be against us, right? Even the mighty nations of the world will all bow at the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Beloved, let this be another testament of the awesome and wonderful things the Lord our God can do.